there's a site called Lou Rockwell, who are our guests coming up in the next segment, and we're very privileged to have, and he's a local expert on the Second Amendment. His name is Marc Victor, and if you've ever gone to the gun shows down at the crossroads, he used to show up out there, and he would give seminars for free in the outside, and that's where I first met him. So we hope to have him calling in a little bit, and we'll hear what he's been up to. He'll give you a different perspective on the Second Amendment. He's not perhaps an expert like Neil Knox or some of the other folks, but from the law, from the lawyer's perspective, he is. And for all of you that have ever taken a concealed carry class, what do they tell you to do? If there's an incident, what should you do? You put your gun down, you call the police, and you don't say anything until you talk to your lawyer. And I don't have Marc on retainer, but I have his card in my wallet so that if I were ever involved in an incident like this, what lawyer are you going to call? Are you going to call your family divorce lawyer? No. This is the man that you would want to call. He would guide you through this, and he's going to have some excellent information on how to protect yourself if there is an incident. How about red flag laws? He's going to tell us about that. Perhaps some of the cases he's defended. And also, he's just written a very, very insightful piece on LouRockwell.com, which we're going to talk about. We're going to let him talk about that. And then we'll take some callers and we'll see if we can't educate ourselves. This is Mayor Jeff Serdy of Apache Junction, sitting in for Steve Cates on the Second Amendment Show. So on the line, we have an esteemed guest, and I'm so thankful that he's joined us today, and I'm privileged to have Marc Victor. That's Marc with a C, if you're going to Google this. Marc, are you there?
I'm here, Jeff. Happy Sunday.
And you too, and thanks for taking time out of your Sunday morning to join us. So
thanks for having me.
I gave you a little bit of a biography before, but I believe you're an ex-Marine. There's no such thing as an ex-Marine, though, right?
Yeah, we like to say former Marine.
Yes.
Us jarheads or leathernecks, as you prefer. So, yeah, once you're in the Marine Corps, you never quite get it completely out of your system.
And that's good. So, yes, I have met you before down at gun shows, and I've heard you before. I think you've been interviewed by Steve years ago, but I think you've got some things to give us a different perspective on the Second Amendment. And if anybody wants to call in soon, maybe you could take some calls. Can you stay for more than one segment?
Sure, I'd be happy to.
That would be awesome. So I mentioned Lou Rockwell .com on his blog, on his page. You've kind of came up with an alternative to just law after law after law and how we might be able to police ourselves. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, Jeff, you know, I think we have got to just become more principled as a people, right? We don't emanate from a certain principle. Like, for example, you were talking quite a bit about the Republicans and the Democrats, and, you know, the reason that they're having all of these arguments is just a simple reason. They don't agree on what the basic point is, what the role is of government, right? So we need to have this discussion. When you talk about people like Mayor Bloomberg, say for example, if I was talking to Mayor Bloomberg and he was pitching his big sugary soda ban as he had in the past when he was mayor of New York, and he would make very convincing argument, I think, that these big sugary sodas are really bad for you. And I would agree with him on that point. He would then say, well, because they're bad, they need to be banned by the government. And I would completely disagree with him on that point. And the reason we disagree is because we disagree about the role of government. I mean, I think, like many of the founders of our country thought, and as they said in the Declaration of Independence, that the purpose of government is really to protect our rights. It's so we can pursue life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, and the government is our agent to help us pursue that, to be left alone, if you will. Now, they see government as a completely different purpose, right? Their roles of government may go something like this, right? The purpose of government is to make sure everybody has proper health care and our housing, or that we equalize, amounts of wealth between citizens and things of that nature. In other words, they've got a certain picture of how the world ought to be and the government ought to be used to effectuate that picture. Well, that's a completely different view of the purpose of government. And until we can get to the bottom of that and get some agreement on what this government thing is supposed to be, we're going to have endless disagreements. So, you know, I wrote this article to make the case that really how I think government ought to operate, and I entitled it Live and Let Live as Applied to Guns, because I think live and let live ought to be the general rule, right? That's what the government ought to be doing, in my view. It should be making laws and rules and regulations that are all consistent with this idea that you're in charge of yourself, you are the sovereign, iron-fisted ruler of you, and you can do anything you want with your body, your money, your property, your time, so long as you don't interfere with another person.
And we're such a culturally diverse country. Where Mayor Bloomberg is from, there are people there in New York, they live their entire life and never step on dirt or grass. They live on concrete. They don't know where their food comes from. So they have to go to something, what do they call them, a bodega every night to get their food. Yet we'll have people in Arkansas or South Carolina, they may only have to go to the grocery store once a month. They don't need the government. They don't need anybody to take care of them. They can take care of themselves. So expound on the live and let live principle, and how might that work?
Yeah, you know, I think that you make an excellent point. Because people are diverse in every way you can think of, right? We're diverse economically. We're diverse socially. We're diverse physically. We have different ideas about the world. We sometimes celebrate different holidays. We eat different foods. Some of us speak different languages, and that's okay. In a free country, an open society can tolerate all of those things, no problem. The only thing I think we're saying with this live and let live thing is, look, you are free to both define and pursue your own happiness, right? Because something that might make me happy might not make someone in Arkansas happy or someone in New York City happy, and it doesn't have to, right? Who cares if it doesn't? They should get to live their lives however they want. So to me, the live and let live sort of principle is the thing that recognizes our mutual sovereignty, right? You're in charge of you and I'm in charge of me. Any other rule, to me, fails to recognize the sovereignty of other human beings. So the only thing we really got to figure out is at what point is one person interfering with another person. And I think, as I break down in my article, you know, any time you are initiating force or fraud or coercion, or, as I like to say, and, you know, think self-defense here, right, a substantial risk of such thing. I think any time someone is doing that to another person, they are interfering with you.
And no one is forcing anyone to buy a firearm, but yet they have no right to tell me that I can't defend myself. And you know fully well that Mayor Bloomberg has armed guards around him at all times, anybody that can afford it like that. In the same way with when you're talking about the sugary drinks, yeah, you should have the right to buy them, but in the same sentence, they shouldn't be able to force you to buy a gun or force you to buy insurance. So there's that live and let live principle you're talking about.
Yeah, now in the case of guns, to be fair, and so we have some more interesting conversation here, in the case of guns, I think there are such things that we can look at that merely having a gun, right? Because it's not just your right to self-defense. I mean, you can have a gun for any purpose, right? You might have a gun because you like to go shooting. You might have a gun because you like to look at guns. It's a free country, right? So you get to have a gun. I think you should be left alone unless you are doing one of those things I mentioned before. You're initiating force or fraud or coercion against somebody, or you're creating a substantial risk of those things. So,
and all of those things are against the law, are they not? There's already laws against doing all of those things to people.
Right, and so that's the reason that we might have a policy that say certain people, because they have a gun, like for example, take the violent felon category, right? Here's somebody, imagine a guy who's been convicted of five drive-by shootings and home invasions with guns. I mean, he's a thug with a gun. I think it's certainly proper for us to say if that guy has a gun, he's creating a substantial risk. Why do we say that? Because he's done it in the past. He's proven himself to be an initiator of force. So I think it's perfectly proper for us to say, hey, you don't get to have a gun. You've forfeited your right because you've made yourself a risk to other people. Now, keeping in mind, we're never going to be able to actually keep guns away from all those guys, no more than we can have a law against murder and we're going to prevent all murders, right? But just because murders persist, even though we have laws against murder, doesn't mean that we can't have a rule that says if you're a violent felon, you can't have a gun. But we know they're still going to get them, right? You can almost print them up today if you like. You can steal them. You can buy them in the black market. You can actually make them. They're not that confusing, right? It's something that expels a projectile by the action of an explosive. I mean, that's a firearm, right? So this is the reason why law-abiding citizens want to have guns, because we know bad guys are going to have guns. Okay. I think there are other categories as well, right? I mean, I think there are some people who are so mentally ill that merely having a firearm in their hands creates a substantial risk.
And we'll talk about red flag laws in some other segments. So we're joined with attorney Marc Victor from here in Phoenix. He's a defense attorney and specializes in the Second Amendment, but I believe he'll defend you on whatever. But also, Marc, being a libertarian, what about folks that have paid their dues? Let's say they were sentenced to 10 years in prison. They did their 10 years, and they have got a different attitude. Do you think they should be able to have their rights back?
To me, it all revolves around the same question, right? If we put a gun in your hand to the person who gets released, right? If we put a gun in your hand, do you present a substantial risk of violating somebody's rights? If the answer is yes, then we should do everything we can to make sure the person doesn't have a gun. If the answer is no, then I think we got no business telling them they can't have a gun. So, you know, I think some of these things are going to require a case-by-case basis, which is why I'm in favor of a procedure that says, look, if you've been convicted of a violent felony or any today any felony, but I don't think any felony ought to deprive you of guns. I think only violent felonies. It would potentially maybe a long string of misdemeanor
assault, something like that.
But if you've got a history of violence, I think it's perfectly appropriate for us to say you can't have a gun. But now if you want to make the case that, hey, I'm a reformed guy now, I'm different, I've changed, whatever, I think maybe we ought to have a process where the person applies to have their gun rights reinstated.
In your practice, do you help folks get their rights back?
We do tons of these. There's never a time at my firm in the last 20 years where we haven't had many reinstatement of rights type cases that are pending. They're all different.
That is one of the questions I get a lot at my shop when we do get denies. You know, how do you get your rights back? So this is Mayor Jeff Serdy of Apache Junction. I'm sitting in for Steve Cates on A Call to Rights the last Sunday of every month. We're joined by attorney Marc Victor here in Phoenix, and he's talking all about defending yourself, defending your rights, who should have those rights, and is it a right? And this is Jeff Serdy, owner of AJI Sporting Goods, sitting in for Steve here on A Call to Rights, talking everything Second Amendment. And we're joined by attorney Marc Victor of Phoenix, a very esteemed expert on the Second Amendment. Marc, I always, unlike other hosts, I enjoy hearing from the callers, and we never know what direction they're going to take us. And we've got one on the line now, Tanya, and she asked a very important question last month. Let's see if she's followed up on that or if she wants to talk about something else. Tanya, are you there?
I am here, and I have followed that up.
Why don't you refresh our memory of what you asked, and maybe Marc can chime in.
Hello?
Yes. Yeah, did you hear my question?
So, I guess the idea, from what I've looked into, the idea was that families didn't want to move west because everybody was carrying a gun. People from cities were not used to that. People from other places, they weren't used to that. And in the west, it was so necessary to have a gun, and you would just have it with you all the time. And in order to get people to settle and come west, they just banned guns in town. It's not that you couldn't have a gun anywhere, but that was our first gun laws.
So refreshing everybody and Marc Victor, the question was last month was, when was the first gun law? Was it, I know the Brits tried to put gun laws on us, which led to the Revolutionary War. So, Marc, what do you think? When were the first gun laws, and how did they shape the nation?
You know, I'm not 100% positive about this, but I think that gun laws were in existence at the time when we formed our country. I don't think the founding fathers had in mind anybody can have anything they want at any time with no restrictions. It's pretty clear they didn't have that in mind, because if you think about it, when somebody is sentenced to prison, it's almost nobody ever talks about, well, we can take your gun away because now you're in prison. Most people agree with that. Well, if that's the case, that's a restriction on your right to keep and bear arms under a particular circumstance. So there's nothing that's, if you agree with that, there's nothing that says that's the only restriction. We have to talk about what restrictions make sense for certain types of people. So, I mean, unless you're willing to argue that people sentenced to prison, properly sentenced to prison, ought to be able to take their firearms with them to prison, then I think we're all in agreement there should be some restrictions on the right to keep and bear arms. We just got to figure out which ones are proper.
Right, and does it change from county to county? So, Tanya, thanks for researching that. And, yes, the West, even back then. I'm sorry, I talked over you. What?
I'm sorry. The very first official law, it is the law that you can't carry a gun in town, was in Kansas, and that was in 1889. And until then, there was no law like it. There was nothing that said you couldn't carry in a bar in New York City. There was nothing that said you couldn't carry in a church. There was nothing.
And if you look, I mean, I study the history of firearms. There were so many little pocket guns and gambler's guns, and every shopkeeper had them. So, Tanya may be right. I think that everyone was armed back then, and there wasn't a problem, and society changed.
There was something else, too, and I was actually going to talk about this when I called. Joe Biden responded to something we talked about a month or so or a couple months back in regards to we have our guns to protect ourselves from the government, not each other. He responded to that with this. That's ridiculous. You don't have tanks. You don't have fighter jets. So how could you possibly protect yourself from the government?
Marc, what do you say to that?
I've got news for you, Joe.
Well, what I say to that is
they're not henchmen for a tyrannist.
Okay. This is where I am.
Protect us, the people.
Let's let Marc answer.
I think we're never going to get this issue straight until we can agree on fundamental principles. And I think that the fundamental principle here that makes sense, right, we shouldn't be debating about what's the purpose of guns. I mean, who cares what the purpose of guns is? You may want to have a gun, like for example, you know, I like the AR-15. Now, a lot of people might say, well, that's not a good home defense weapon, or that's this, or that's that, or they make all kinds of different arguments. And, you know, my response back is that's what I carried in the United States Marine Corps. That's what I was trained on. That's what I'm most comfortable with. And maybe I'm a bit sentimental about that particular weapon. Those are my reasons for liking the AR-15. We don't have to have all the same reasons. So back to what I was saying at the beginning, do whatever you want in a free society. Do whatever you want, have whatever you want, just don't violate the basic rule, which means don't mess with anybody else. Don't initiate force, fraud, or coercion, or don't be a substantial risk of those things to another person. And then we don't have to argue about what's the purpose or when the first gun law was or why you want to have an AR-15. The only question is this person with an AR-15, is that person presenting a substantial threat to another person? If they are, we don't have to tolerate that. If they're not, they should be left alone, whether you like it or don't like it. I mean, this is the rule that makes sense to me, and it's not a special rule for guns. It's the same rule for everything, right? I mean, can't we apply the same rule to smoking marijuana? If you're smoking marijuana peacefully in your backyard and you're not bothering anybody, you're not interfering with another person, you should be left alone.
And I wanted to talk about that in the last segment, so we'll save that. So, Tanya, thanks for the research and thanks for the question, and I hope to hear from you again. I think she's already gone. But also, if anybody else wants to call in, 602-277-5369, we're on with Marc Victor, noted defense attorney. So, Marc, I read your blog, your posting on Lou Rockwell, and a lot of it, you know, the beginning of it, it's really a nice read, but of course, someone that's in the industry, I've heard a lot of it. Until you get down a ways in, then you start getting into some other things, and you wrote something that made a lot of sense to me, and that is the government is a fictitious entity. It is actually the people who control all mechanisms of government. There is no thing called the government. We're the government, and we change it to however we want it to be. And when it gets out of hand, which we're seeing now with this deep state and the impeachment crap, so why don't you expound on what you were meaning on when you wrote that?
Well, you know, we like to talk about the government like it's this real thing, like the government does this or the government does that, but the government is just a fictitious entity, right? It's sort of like a corporation. There's not actually, you can't meet the corporation. There are people who work there. There are people who speak on behalf of the corporation, people who do things on behalf of the corporation. The government is the same way. And the problem we have is, I don't know what better way to put it, but we got a bunch of idiots in there running the government. And maybe some might say accurately, this is our fault. And it's our fault because we don't emanate from the correct principles, right? We put the idiots in there. They didn't just fall out of the sky. They were dropped in there. So if we could get people in there who emanate from the proper principle, which I'm calling the live and let live principle. I mean, to me, what could be a more American principle than the idea of just live and let live? And, this is,
and I say all the time here, the government starts here on the local level. I made a choice 14 years ago. I ran for city council and I was elected. And then after that, I took it on to mayor. But it's so important, more so locally than even nationally, with school boards and the county sheriff. The county sheriff is the most, you know, important person in every county because they can actually tell the feds, you know, what they're going to do in their own county. And so I always encourage people to run for office and get involved. And I always kind of irks me when people go right for senator. Of course, President Trump went right for president, and he did it, and he's doing an excellent job. I mean, a lot of people think the best president ever, but it's not a bad idea to start somewhere local and then take it from there.
Yeah, I mean, I think whatever people do to promote liberty is a great thing. I mean, the first thing I ask people to do is look in the mirror. Are you part of the problem? Or are you part of a solution, right? To me, part of the solution means you recognize the principles of a free society. You're interested in a free society. You are tolerant enough to recognize that other people get to do things that you disagree with as long as they're peaceful. Like, if that's something that you agree with, then you're part of the solution. So, yes, run for office, write articles, do whatever you like. If you don't get that point, if you just think that you know how to run the world and you're going to use the government to impose your particular views on everybody else of what's right and what's wrong and how people ought to live, then I would say you're part of the problem.
Which I opened up the show with, is the Second Amendment safe? And it feels like it is now. But here's an example of what can happen. And, of course, the Democrats always said, well, Obama didn't take any guns. Well, they sure try. And what just happened in Virginia, the entire state house in Virginia has now flipped over to Democrat because Virginia, if you don't know that area, Virginia is basically Washington, D.C., Virginia and parts of Maryland. Everybody that works in Washington, D.C., they don't live there. They live in the tops of the other states. And now in Virginia, we're seeing that they are already gearing up to really come after firearms. So this is an example of what can happen if you don't control it on the local level.
And these are people who generally understand freedom pretty well in some of the civil liberties areas, right? I mean, a lot of these Democrats who hate the Second Amendment are champions of the First Amendment, champions of the Fourth Amendment, the Fifth Amendment, the Sixth Amendment. They understand civil liberties. They want to let you do whatever you want. They say the kinds of things like keep government out of your bedroom. They understand individual rights and responsibilities when it comes to other areas. And I always say to them, do you not see the Second Amendment listed in the Bill of Rights? Do you not understand
that? Which keeps all the other amendments safe. So we're running out of time here, Mark. I'd hope to have some other callers join us at 602-277-5369. We're on with defense attorney Marc Victor. He's going to stay for our last segment, and we're going to get into red flag laws and recreational marijuana, which I believe is going to be on the ballot next time. We're going to have to deal with that, especially someone like myself who does background checks. How do we handle that? We'll see. We've got on the line Marc Victor, noted defense attorney here in the Valley. And we're going to get to, first off, we had a call. We had a caller that didn't want to stay on, but he just wanted to point out about why people should own guns. He's former law enforcement. If you hear glass breaking at 2 in the morning and somebody's in your house, you've got to take care of yourself. And they may well have a ball bat or a knife or a firearm. Unless you have equal firepower, the police are maybe 10 minutes away. So that's yet one of the best reasons to own a firearm. So, Marc, I want to talk about a couple things. One, red flag laws. Governor Doug Ducey, he's been trying to introduce them. And luckily, there again, local elections, our legislature's not really getting behind it. For some reason, he wants to push that. We have another person, and this is a question all to itself about, we just had Colonel Vindman, and a lot of people think you cannot question him because he's an ex-vet. We have another ex-vet that we all like, and that's Representative Dan Crenshaw, who's doing a great job other than the fact that he is for red flag laws. So I think that just because you're an ex-vet does not mean we can't question you when you are governing over us. So on red flag laws, what, Marc, what is your take on that, and is there any way to do some preventive maintenance to keep yourself from being red flagged?
Well, you know, I actually am happy to sound like a broken record on this point, right? I think the issue is always the same. If somebody doesn't present a substantial risk, then we have no business messing with them. The question is, do they present a substantial risk? And so we've already got laws on the books here in Arizona that somebody can go down to the courthouse and say, look, I want an order of protection or an injunction against harassment, depending on the nature of the relationship in question, and then check a box that says, yes, this person is a substantial danger, and I think their guns should be taken away. So what happens at that point is there's a hearing in front of a judge, right? So the judge has to hear the evidence. We can all imagine circumstances, right, that the evidence could be such that the proper thing for the judge to do is to say, yes, send the police out there and take this guy's guns away because he's, you know, threatening people with a gun. He's got problems in his past. He's got this, that, or the next thing. And we should, because he presents a substantial risk, we should take his guns away.
But unfortunately, however, a judge in New Jersey or Massachusetts is going to be different than a judge in Payson, Arizona or Safford, Arizona.
Well, we have to first figure out the right rules. Once we get the right rules, then let's focus on getting judges who apply the right rules correctly. And so there is guidance in this area, right? There are things like the burden of proof. And so what I would say is the burden of proof needs to be on the person making the allegation. That seems obvious. That's, to me, a due process matter. So they should have the burden of proof. Then once there's a hearing, the burden of proof should remain on the person who's making the accusation. In addition to that, what is the level of proof that's required? Is it mere preponderance of the evidence? I would say it should be higher than that. I think if you're going to try to take somebody's guns away, you ought to be you should have to convince a judge by clear and convincing evidence that this person is a substantial threat with that gun right now. But if they can do that, okay, fine. I think this person presents a risk. Let's take the guns. If they can't do that, then I think that the person ought to be restored immediately. Their guns ought to be given back to them. There should be no expense to them. They shouldn't have to suffer any grief. And maybe even there should be a civil suit for the person who made the false allegation against them. I don't have any problem with any of those things.
Yes. And there again, the judges, a lot of times the ones that issue the take them are also the ones that would be the one in charge of giving them back. A lot of municipalities, I think Tempe and Tucson, they don't give guns back. They destroy them. I know Tucson does. A lot of the cities, I know this from, this is one of the things that made me run, was the city of Apache Junction destroyed over 1,000 guns without going before the council. And just think of the money that could have been used for that. So,
Jeff, this is what I mean when I say we have idiots running the government, right? Even if you don't like guns, why wouldn't you sell the guns and generate money to do something productive with that rather than destroy something that has value in the world?
You don't destroy, when a car runs over somebody, you don't destroy the car. That's always been just...
Well, this, This is because people erroneously look at the gun itself as a bad thing, right? A gun is a tool, just like a car is a tool or a hammer is a tool.
They didn't ban Kool-Aid after Jonestown.
I mean, these tools can all be used for good things or for bad things.
All right, we have a caller. Do we have David?
Yes.
What would you like to ask Marc Victor?
Yeah, I just want to thank him for his input, and I had a comment on the conversation that came up with that lady. It's one that I think Marc's very clear approach to what the understanding should be is what was behind a lot of the founders' thinking. You know, if it doesn't really interfere with somebody, people should be more or less free to do it. But on the debate, if you read some of the accounts of the debates at the time, they were still concerned that they should enshrine something in there in the Bill of Rights for the right to bear arms. And then in response to, Joe Biden's comments, the argument, it should never be, well, if they have bigger weapons than us, so we might as well forget about it then, because it would be a limited engagement normally under those circumstances. A tyrannical government would never want to wipe out its population. They just want to subdue them. And there are so many ex-military in the population already in population that's relatively armed. And also you have people in the armed forces who would not like to see such a thing happen. So it can be a very effective situation to have, to have an armed society. And the, so arguments like that need to be brought up more often, I think.
Marc, your thoughts?
Yeah, I generally agree with the comments that were made. I like to say this, too, when talking about the founding fathers. We shouldn't talk about them either as if they were all of one mind, because they weren't. There were lots of them with different opinions, or that they were right on everything, because they weren't right on everything, right? The founding fathers also almost totally approved of slavery. And so, when they wrote these things, they weren't thinking about black people. They decided it's okay to have them as slaves. So obviously, they were mistaking in a huge way about some very fundamental issues. We shouldn't hold up everything they said as sort of sacrosanct. We should take the good parts of what they said and improve on those things with the goal in mind that what we're really trying to accomplish here is a free society. That's the goal. And so all things need to be interpreted, including the Second Amendment. Take, for example, the Fourth Amendment. The Fourth Amendment protects you against unreasonable searches and seizures. Well, what's unreasonable? There's no guidance there. You have to fill in what's unreasonable. In the same way with the Second Amendment, there are many things that need to be filled in. Let's fill them in a way that promotes a free society.
Yeah, if you want to kill several hours, get on YouTube and watch about people telling police that they can't search their car, and then sometimes they win and sometimes they get their windows knocked out. It's always interesting. David, thanks for the call.
Thank you, sir.
Marc, before we run out of time, I know reading about you that you have debated County Attorney Bill Montgomery about drugs. In my profession of selling firearms, there is a question on there. Are you an unlawful user of drugs? And it looks like recreational marijuana is going to be on the ballot next year, and there's already 11 states. We could be number 12. And ATF, they don't know how to handle it. They're kind of just ignoring it. What are your thoughts on if marijuana becomes approved? And tell me some more about your history on that and your debate.
Well, I can say that to me, the issue of marijuana is exactly the same as the issue regarding guns. I approach them exactly the same way. Do whatever you want. Unless you're bothering someone else, creating a risk to someone else, you should be left alone. So, the exceptions start coming in with marijuana. When you say smoke marijuana, now you're in your car and you're driving and you're reckless and you're endangering other people. Okay, that's when the government should get involved and say you can't do that. But anything that allows people to do whatever they want, and when I say people, I mean competent adults, to do whatever they want with their bodies, their property, their money, their time, I'm in favor of that, whether I like it or not. That's a free society. This issue about how it interacts with guns is something that's hugely up in the air. This is the kind of thing that, because we really don't know what is in President Trump's head on this issue, because he's got quotes on both sides of this issue. We don't know what his position is as to marijuana. This needs to be fixed on the federal level, because even in the states where it's legal, and I agree with you, I think it will be on the ballot in Arizona. There are a couple of competing initiatives. They're probably both going to be on the ballot. And I think it is going to pass, and I think it ought to pass. And so we're going to have recreational marijuana in this state very soon. But if it's illegal federally, then everybody is committing federal crimes. This, of course, is because of a ridiculous interpretation of the Commerce Clause that gives the federal government the jurisdiction to get involved in the drug war in the first place.
In your practice, have you defended anyone who came after by the feds or locally about firearms and legal marijuana, medical marijuana?
I'm not aware of one case that deals with somebody with a medical marijuana card who had a gun, who they were pursued by the federal government. So I don't think that's something that they're doing right now, because generally there have been some success with depriving the federal government of dollars to go after people who are in compliance with state medical marijuana laws. However, it gets very sticky, as you correctly note, as someone who has an FFL. You are required not to sell a firearm to somebody you have reasonable grounds to believe is a illegal user of marijuana. Now, if you see a medical marijuana card in somebody's wallet when they're trying to buy a firearm, you, yep, according to the law right now of the Ninth Circuit, you have reasonable grounds to believe they're
same
an illegal
way if,
user.
If someone comes in and appears to be intoxicated. And,
you can't sell them a firearm. Now, on the other hand, there's nothing wrong with simply having a medical marijuana card.
And we're running out of time. I'm hearing the music play. And, Marc, thanks so much for joining us here. And thank you, Steve Cates, for letting me have the Second Amendment Minute. I think Steve's out looking at meteor showers or something. He'll be back next week. This has been Mayor Jeff Serdy sitting in for Steve Cates on A Call to the Right.